Hello, I'm Sandy Davies. I'm coming to you today from Eastern Goobie-Yalanji country, upon whose lands I live. I'd like to take this opportunity to acknowledge the elders, past, present, and emerging, all of whom I have deep, abiding respect for. This land is the remote tropics of far north Queensland, on the edge of the World Heritage Listed Daintree Rainforest, where it meets the cusp of the fringing reef of the Great Barrier Reef. I just wanted to take you on a walk today with me through Jalumba, the world's most ancient continual rainforest, and I wanted to connect you to its magical power. However, outside there is a cyclone looming and the rain has come, so sit with me here inside in this peaceful place as we chat about living above your station and rediscovering your power to rise above. My husband and I have thousands of tourists sigh with envy. You are so lucky. And you live here. My message to you is that luck has nothing to do with our happiness. Regardless of where you are in your life or what you're facing, I believe that we choose our perception of paradise, we choose our attitude, and we choose whether and when to rise. You see, I believe within all of us we have the power to rise. Let me say that one more time. Within us, we all have the power to rise. No matter where you are on this magnificent planet while you're listening to my story today, you too have the infinite power to rise. If you're dissatisfied with your surroundings or situations placed upon you, you have the power to choose and to create your next step. Our life in paradise isn't luck like so many visitors think. It took infinite hard work, and with that we embraced our power, rose, and made our dreams a reality. And yes, by the way, that was me that you saw turning a page. I'm going to refer to my notes throughout our conversation, as I do not want to miss a single thing. A part of my life mission is to break down the stigma of menopause and bring conversations about that transition era in women's lives into the mainstream. I've been called vulgar by men who even in this century still feel menstruation, birth, and menopause should remain unspoken. I've been an object of ridicule and subject to inappropriate behavior since launching my menopause is a happy pause mission. I guess all that chatter means I'm doing a good job. But one of the symptoms with menopause is brain fog. And brain fog can also bring anxiety and a loss of confidence, even if you've been confident throughout adulthood. I don't remember how many speeches I've given in the past, but that brain fog for me personally in this moment means that I cannot effectively memorize speeches at my best. So my notes today symbolize that we are all human and we do not have to be perfect in every moment. Hey, notes are okay. Do life, do presentations, do living your best life your way, 100%. With notes or without, whatever you are facing, you have got this. You know, just like Penny Ford and Snap from that 1990s anthem, I've got the power. So by now, you may have begun to notice that my accent is not 100% Australian. You may have even picked up on that ever so slight, absolutely lush bit of a tiny Welsh lilt. You'll find out about that in the future. I'm not only a woman of the tides, I am a woman of the world. I was born and raised in Greensburg, Kansas, in the Midwest of the United States. My father served in the Navy in World War II, then returned home to marry his small town sweetheart, who, by the way, in 1949, was the first ever female leader in Kansas of a Glenn Miller-esque style big band. Even back then, my mom was a glass ceiling breaker. But more about my beautiful mom soon. My father became a grocery store manager. For any of you who are Richard Kiyosaki fans, my parents had the poor dad ethics in Rich Dad, Poor Dad. My dad worked hard, and he saved. And my mama raised us right, including raising me as the only girl to use my voice, be forthright, and never, ever keep my mouth shut. Thank you so much, Mom. Then in the mid-1980s, Their world fell apart. They lost everything. The savings and loan crisis saw their savings disappear right before their very eyes. And as if that wasn't enough, the grocery store chain my dad was working for was bought out by a larger company. The new corporate owners started at one end of Kansas and drove through to the other, stopping at every store with a World War II veteran manager over the age of 50 and firing them on the spot to avoid the cost of carryover retirement benefits. A number of the other managers committed suicide. Luckily, my dad did not, but he fell into a deep, deep depression. At age 50, my mother had to reinvent herself and find work with no experience under her belt. She was scared. She had doubts. She faced rejection again and again, but she didn't give up. She found her feet through selling Mary Kay cosmetics. Back then, the pinnacle of Mary Kay's success was a pink Cadillac. My mom set her goal on earning that caddy lease. I helped her do Mary Kay after Mary Kay event. She reached that goal, but before she could take possession of that pink caddy, a step up emerged and she entered the financial industry. She was so 9 to 5, just like the Dolly Parton song. There were very few women in the industry. She became the first of so many things. Just like in the 1940s when she'd become the first female band leader, now here she was in the 1980s, becoming the first woman in the state to have a full securities license and smashing glass ceilings in a man's world. As a teenager, I was so proud of her. Let me read you a passage from the book I co-authored called Courage and Confidence, What It Really Takes to Succeed in Business. In this book, I wrote about my mother in the chapter, The Courage to Leap, lessons I didn't realize my mother taught me. We cannot control the behavior of others, but we can control our attitude and how we react. I decided a long, long time ago that letting others steal my joy gave them far too much power. Growing up in the wheat belt of the American Midwest, rural counties had driving laws that allowed kids as young as 14 to get their driving license. The purpose was enabled farm kids to drive wheat trucks to the elevator during harvest, but it also meant that all us country kids got to legally drive from a very young age, even if we could barely see over the steering wheel. It was awesome. I equated driving with freedom, especially on the wide open highways of the Great Plains. Whenever my mother needed a driver, I was her gal. I spent many of my teen years driving those long highways to attend motivational seminars with my mother as she built her career. Early on, I hand wrote a message from one of those seminars and taped it to my mirror where I would see it as a daily reminder. I can't remember now if it was Zig Ziglar, Louise Hay, Wayne Dyer, Tony Campolo, or Stephen Covey who pointed their finger at this little girl in the front row of the Cosmosphere Convention Center in Hutchinson, Kansas, and said, "If you let someone else ruin your day, they've won." But to this day, I am still adamant that they are totally right. Stay focused on the joy that emanates from within rather than letting others spoil your day. There's just something about lifting the corners of our lips that connects to the receptors in our brain to reset our attitude and get us back on track to get through the rest of the day. And I close that chapter with a quote from one of my favorite theologians, Henry Nouwen. Joy does not simply happen to us. We have to choose joy and keep choosing it every day. It was such a privilege to honor my courageous mother's legacy through this book, Courage and Confidence. And Women Making a Difference Press have also asked me to co-author Dr. Tara Rye Trent's upcoming anthology, Sacred Promise. In Sacred Promise, you'll get the opportunity to discover a bit more about my journey and my sacred promise. Which brings me to a pivotal moment in life where I had to decide whether I would let others define me or if I would rise through my own power. I was a brainiac in high school. I knew I wanted more. For me, the path to more was knowledge and education. I was so proud when I earned enough academic scholarships to be able to afford to go to college. I would go on to become the first girl in my family to get a university degree. And I was a girl. I was so excited. So was my mum, who believed in the power of my wing. That excited mom planned a huge high school graduation party. My computer science teacher gave a speech about my potential and the brilliant future he was sure lay ahead for one of his favorite ever students. The room was filled with joy. Until, that is, my grandma stood up and clapped her hands. The applause stopped, and before she spoke, I could feel the change in the air within the room. Y'all need to stop this nonsense right now. You people putting notions in this girl's head, you've got her thinking above her station. And I didn't hear the rest, as a deafening roar arose within my soul. Apparently my brother was getting ready to try to intervene when he saw my lips part. I said plenty, all right. I remember right up until my brother's death, he used to laugh and tell about the fiery independent tornado that I let rip at my graduation party. In fact, when he introduced me to his true soulmate, Sarah, decades later, a few months before he unfortunately died by suicide, that speech was the first story that he proudly told about his kid sister, much to my chagrin. So back to high school. After high school, I graduated with honors with a Bachelor of Science from Kansas State University and completed my master's degree overseas in Australia as an ambassador of goodwill. It was during that sojourn in Australia that I met my soulmate, a magical soul. He too dreamed of much more, more. And that brought him to leaving his family's farm in Wales in search for more. And now here we are, in the lucky country, regularly listening to tourists wistfully proclaim our luck amidst their own dissatisfaction with theirs. Others do not define you. Others cannot destroy your resilience. Sometimes we somehow let them sneak in under our armor. Sometimes they think they've won. But even if you are in a moment where you feel they are right or you are doubting yourself, you are resilient. You will rise. You have the power. Yep, there I am again, humming that snap anthem. I've got the power. It will guide you. Never let anyone else define your station. You and what you can achieve are infinite, no matter your age or circumstance. I'm living proof. I'm living my best life, choosing joy, and allowing my power to continue to rise almost 4 decades after that tongue lashing by my grandma. I am grateful for her thinking so little of me. Her lack of expectation fueled mine. I'm so thankful I recognized my power to rise and be more so long ago. It has stood me strong across this life of slings and arrows of misfortune. It has prompted me to take arms against a sea of troubles, like speaking about menopause out loud. Here I am in my 50s, finally appreciating why we had to study Shakespeare in school. Now I know the answer is within that very first line of the Hamlet soliloquy. Because you see, when the prince says, to be or not to be, well, my friends, the answer is simply be. Be. Be you. Be free. Be true to yourself. Be true to your own inner power. Recognize your power to rise above, and you too will be deemed lucky by others. Have the courage and the confidence to leap. You've got this.